And it's this. It's the Minifon P55 Cold War Spy Recorder. Ugh. Ugh. That's a latex foam pad that is just totally turned to crunchy, crunchy crust. All right. Ooh, man, this is so intricate. I guess all the latex is just gone. This is totally dried out. All right, we got a HiVac tube here. Super sub miniature. Looks like a dual triode in there. And there's a rubber clutch on there. So it's definitely, you know, we're talking the same size as a modern cassette. So they really, for what it is, this is really amazing. Hey, it's Fran, again, in the lab, with headphones on, kind of unusual. But I stand before a monolith. This is, in my humble opinion, the greatest effect ever created. They're kind of rare now, but this is a vintage Echo Plate 2 Plate Echo. This is what it sounds like, just going to the mic and going right to the recorder. It's flat, lifeless, and in mono. But if I bring in the Echo Plate 2, this is Plate Echo. Let me open the front and show you what it is. The driver, which is basically just a speaker driver that's mounted to the plate in the center. It uses the plate in basically like a speaker cone would. It resonates the plate. And then it has these two transducers, which are, I believe, magnetic. But I'm not going to tear it apart. And unfortunately, they're riveted shut. So I'm not going to open up. I'm not going to destroy this. And I'm not going to misalign it. But the two transducers, one on either side of the plate, it creates a stereo image of the reverberation of the plate, so you get a stereo output. And the plate is held in the corners by these turnbuckles, and apparently the plate itself is made out of a special alloy. Got a pencil. That's it for this one. I'm Fran. I'll see you in the lab real soon. Thanks to all my patrons for making this possible. It's Fran, again, in the lab, with some very special friends. I picked some favorites out of my Laserdisc collection, and since it was part of the move where I was about to sort it all and I had to build a rack to store the Laserdiscs and such, I thought that I would give a little video about my own perspective of why Laserdisc was such an amazing, and is, continues to be, such an amazing format. These photographs, and I'm going to show the jog shuttle here. Yeah, so you can go through and frame by frame and look at every single photograph individually. And there's also a jog shuttle control on the remote. So it was, you know, really great. The oddball films. People who've seen this film have very strong opinions of it, The Human Highway, but this is one of my prized Laserdiscs. It's one of my pet favorites. Devo are in it, and Devo and Neil Young have this big coked out jam session that's just totally just stuck in there. It's not part of the film. It's just all of a sudden it's happening. But the whole film, Human Highway, it basically if you really needed it to be explained, it's like Neil Young made a film about the people who live on a Lionel train platform, and he plays a character in the film called Lionel. Hello? This whole film is just one big coked out mess, but it's also fun. I like, you gotta watch it with absolutely no expectations. It's got some memorable moments. So, but yeah, cult classic, personal favorite. So anyway, that's my take about Laserdiscs and my love of Laserdiscs. I still love the format. I love the look of the packaging. It's nostalgic, but it's also still functional. So the first thing I had to do was to go into the artwork, and this is the composite that I had made with all the different layers, and I've colored them so that they have the appropriate color for how they'd end up in the disky. And these files I had separated in for the original silkscreens. But I have the silver layer, which would give all of the luminous parts. The dots, which would be the white dots. That's the gray bar layer. And the lettering layer, which is in black. And this would be the phosphor layer, which is going to be actually the background, the first layer of the shirt. It's my old tried and true UV exposure tank. Where I have mounted in on the bottom two photographic contact printers or very high resolution silk screens because you don't have any of the angular issues. Sorry, I'm going for the first try, putting a sheet down, and then I'm going to carefully place the artwork on that with the ink side down, and then I'm going to put down the heavy glass lid and putting the lid on, starting the exposure, and I'm gonna go for 60 minutes plus. Always check to make sure that the light is actually on. All right, so after an hour we got an exposed plate, and I'm gonna very carefully separate the artwork. I'm doing this in subdued light. I've got the camera gain all the way up. There's no safety light with this stuff. After I get all the screens exposed, it's time to go to the sink again and peeling off that Mylar back, getting it wet. And again, I went through this with the other video with the t-shirt, and running under cool water, after a few minutes the emulsion will start to soften up and you'll begin to see little breaks in the areas that were not exposed. This tape is very, very high tack adhesive. Again, once again, I'm going to apply a little bit of tension. Now each time that I'm going to mount these, I'm checking against the master artwork just to make sure there aren't any deviations. And there are registration marks in the corners of all the screens. And I line those up with crosses that are in the master artwork. And I'm going to be spraying some contact adhesive onto these so that I can use them to hold down the shirt on the inside to do these multiple layer screens and keep the shirt and register. Just using this regular easy tack, and I'm going to use my Vornado paint mixer. This thing is just it's just a wonder. I originally bought this because I used to use a lot of spray paint in the older days, especially doing pedals and prototypes and stuff, and I got tired of shaking paint, so I got this Vornado, and I can actually do two cans at a time. Using the sample target again, just so that I can align the very first screen. So I'm going to take a piece of chalk and actually just rub chalk through those registration marks to access that actually be used for register for all of the subsequent layers. But those are the chalk marks there. And so that looks about right. And so I figure I'm going to try. Here I forgot to turn on the camera when I did the first print, so wipe off the tools, use the heat gun to dry that first layer, and so that's going to help to sort of charge the luminous ink and give it a little more gusto, if you will. Mix it in a little bit and take a look at it after it's fully mixed, and it's looking better, but I need it to be much more of like a little more yellow-green. So I keep mixing that. So with the black light on it, I can get the screen alignment as visually good as it can be. So with a new loading of ink and a better technique, See, that's the way it's supposed to be. One long shot, another long shot. And you want to make sure that the last swipe is completely clear. Right? And then using the double handle method, and there you go. That's a solid print. Yep. It's getting very disky-like. So now once again, I have to take that screen off. I've reclaimed the ink off of it. Each layer, every time that I take the screen off, I have to go and run it under the water and clean all of the ink out. And one of the things that I do to reclaim the screen each time is blow compressed air through it. So I've got my compressor running with an air gun. The fluorescent ink, now this isn't glow-in-the-dark, it's just regular like fluorescent, but it really is reflecting the UV really well. But it will be a really good backing for the photoluminescent ink. Make sure there's no visual deviation whatsoever. And you can really see why having the complete waterproof screen setup makes this a lot easier. Holding down the screen with one hand, being firm again, all the way through. Two. It's also sort of grippy ink. It has a gritty feel to it. It's those particles. Oh, getting very disky-like. Look at that. And I'm very anxious to get the black light on this and see how well it fluoresces. And it's really bright. So now we're going for the dots. Be liberal with the ink when you're going to do the setup, because you're going to reclaim that ink. After you do your passes, you're going to use a squeegee to get that ink off, put it back in the can. So you're really not going to waste a lot. But again, a few good swipes. And we have dots. All right. Not very scientific. I'm not going for historic accuracy on this because, like I said, it's on a shirt. Yeah, I'm going to lay down the ink onto that temporary trough area. A few good short strokes. And we've got gray bar. And again, I've got to do the same thing, reclaim the ink, basic black that I've mixed, and again, just a few passes, basic black. And we have Disky.
It's one small step for
Fran.
One giant leap for
Fran. All right. For real. I can with the heat gun. There's a lot of layers on this, so, and you know, this has been over the course of one day, the final print. But there it is. I was really, really happy to see this. And put a little black light on it, and it really just glows. It's just great. It's perfect. So I'm heating up my shirt press to 160 degrees Celsius, which is the curing temperature for these inks. They have to be heat set. Press gets up to 160°C. I'm gonna watch the timer, and I'm going to keep it in the press for about 5 minutes. But it's done. It is heat set. A Disky shirt. There you go. From original concept to execution. Perfect. Anyway, that's it for this one. Thanks for hanging around. Thanks to all my patrons for sticking it out and making all these videos possible, for making this shirt possible. Bye! This is day one of Project Egress, the FranLab report. I had a few other days where I had to really decide if I was going to be in, and yesterday I spent the day gathering materials. I went all around town grabbing like parts and such, so, you know, and also evaluating ideas of how I'd fabricate this. And over the last 48 hours or so, I've come up with several different permutations of the assembly. All right. Hey, it's Fran again. This is Project Egress mission log. Day 9, made some progress over at the factory, milling the basic components. I also make a template, just a blank stamp that I use just to create a pocket for that shape in the block that will allow me to quickly mill down the wood to the layer of the first face that's going to be in that part. So when I arrange all the different components of an assembly into the block in the virtual space, first thing I do is I arrange a bunch of these pocket blocks, and I've already done the math on the drawings to figure out how much I have to eliminate in each pocket to get down to the face level, thinking, you know, this the thickness of the block, all the blocks are 19.1 millimeters, so I have to subtract the material working in negative numbers, because the origin is coming from a negative number as far as the part that I'm milling is concerned. And the final step is to switch to a smaller bit and very carefully mill out and to part these individual pieces out of the block. A lot of progress. And there were just a few interruptions along the way. bird alerts would go off. Dot, the shop bird, when she hears me knocking around in my shop, she often likes to come in and visit me. And there were a few Dot visits to be had.
Okay, all flight controllers, go, no, go for landing. Retro,
go,
auto,
go,
guidance,
go,
control,
go,
Falcon,
go,
GNC,
go,
Econ,
go,
Surgeon,
go,
Capcom, we're go for landing.
That's right, Gene. Hey, it's Fran again, early in the morning, in the office, but it's Project Egress, the FranLab log, day 11. And so yesterday I did the first bonding. I had to come up with a way of starting to join these assemblies into solid parts. And I came up with a rig to do that. I'm glued together one part of the rotator, and that's been sitting all night bonding with Type Bond 3. But yeah, it's coming along. I've, you know, got all of the major parts machined. I had to come up with a way of doing some of the hand finishing and come up with this micro sawing jig. So I put down this sacrificial block, taped it down to one of my work tables, and then using another squared block so that I could square the saw using a very fine-toothed model saw, being able to shear off some of these angles. The bottom, there's already a hole drilled in the base for a guide for me to place that for the roller, because I didn't have an actual drawing of it. I had the STL file, but I didn't have a drawing of it so that I could fabricate it and get the measurements right. I made a drawing. Hey, it's Fran again. Day 14, I bonded the puller, which I had made in two halves, so that I could get the maximum number of milling operations with the origin and get those sort of radiuses that I wanted around where the bearing goes in, you know, to get it, you know, as written on the sheet. And I had to bond those two together along with a bearing tube that's going to not only hold the two in alignment, but also be the bearing for the pin that's going to be going in the base. And so I got those glued together and fabricate and finish and square and true these squaring blocks. And using a protractor and just translating angles from the paper designs, doing some calculations to figure out the, you know, the negative angles I would need for the blocks and such, the base artwork, and then pocketed out some holes within those holes to force fit some nuts in there, some 1/4 inch and number 6 nuts, just so that I could use some existing hardware I had to hold that base to the squaring block, and then that squaring block is going to be used to do the remaining operations on the base. And then the two blocks I made, the one for the rotator head, I had mounted the rotator head to that with a screw through where the bearing is going to go, just to hold it firm, and with a washer, and also a little bit of two-sided tape
under it to keep it, you know, straight and true with the line so that it's not going to wiggle around or want to migrate while I'm doing the operations. And I did the same thing with the latch link block, which has a piece of tape. And also, because it's so small and delicate, I couldn't depend on the tape to hold it in place during drilling and grinding. So I had to fabricate this little tiny aluminum plate, like a little cross plate, to that is going to be screwed crossways over the top, just to hold down that latch link to the block so that it's not going to fly off the the tool while I'm, you know, machining it and doing these last processes for the latch link. I have yet to actually do the latch link, but I've done the rotator head. I, you know, hand contoured a radius on the head as per spec and had this amazingly complicated clamp down setup on my drill press that I've ever done for a single hole. And so it's clamped in place, but also clamped in place are, I have these shim blocks underneath as a follow through so that, you know, there's something for the drill bit to hit. A drafting set had this compass that was just for scribing. And I've been using that precision compass to translate, take it from the caliper, using a magnifier to, you know, line up the centers of the compass pins to the edge of the caliper, and then translating that to the actual parts using squaring blocks, and so that I have a squared surface to go from as a reference with the compass, and I scribe into the wood. Yeah, we're into the old school stuff now. I'm using cabinet making and clock making, techniques. Centuries old stuff to do the finishing. So we started with CNC, we're ending with centuries old cabinet and clock making techniques. But that's how that's how I want the factory to be. The whole idea of the factory was to combine the old and the new. The most charming and traditional ways, merging it with the most modern, practical, and accurate. The first ones I've cut by hand using my mini miter system and my mini miter saw, just having a squaring block, putting the saw right up against that, using it as a square, cutting it down, and then gradually hand filing it in that same squaring block using the squaring edge for the file, and filing down the bearing and then checking the fit, filing down, checking the fit. And I did that for the rotator bearing, and it had to fit in the recess of the base. And I filed it down until I just got it in there. Because I want this, like I said, I want this to be tight, but smooth and goozy. So just kind of rub a little line into the Sharpie. And that line is the absolute maximum length of the pin as when it's going to be finished. A little cutting oil, a few little quick passes, and just, you know, make sure that's flat. I also put a tiny little chamfer on the outside, fillet, bevel, however you want to describe it, just on the outside of the one end of the pin. And then brought the cutter around and did just a sort of a plunging cut, taking into consideration the angle of the cutter that I'm using. Again, putting a bevel in there so that when I part it, that I'll be able to, you know, face it down and it's going to be exactly the right length. Before I parting it, I was going to polish up the pin. Started with 220 grit sandpaper to take all the sort of patina off, and then went to 330 grit, and after it was sort of cleaning off the patina, I switched to 2000 grit with cutting oil, and did that wet and completely polished up the pin before parting it. You cannot use too much cutting oil when you're parting. Oil, 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 more oil, 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 until dropped it off. And then after I had the pin parted, I turned the pin around, put that in the chuck, just did some very, you know, easy facing on that pin just to take off the little chunk that was left and do a little, fine finishing. And the end result, I took the brass bearing sleeve from the rotator that I had fabricated and made it up with the pin, and it's totally smooth and goozy, and it was a very optimistic look at how the action would be, and I was very satisfied with the whole process. I was like, at that point, it was like, yeah, this really is going to be coming together. I'm going to be putting the rotator together from the three component parts. I'm going to be bonding them together on the bearing tube to make a complete assembly. And then that has to be hand finished, sanded down, filed down, get all the roughness out of it, get it finished.
Do, do, do. Dun, dun, dun. Dun, dun. All right, here we go. This is it, the completed latch assembly, made all out of walnut. Yep, got the little wheel on it. Nee, nee, nee. Oh yeah, look at that. Turned out beautiful. A little personalized, slightly. Brass inserts for the bolt holes that are gonna hold it down. Little pin stop there. Yep. All goozy and steel pin, brass bearing action. It's quiet as a mouse and functional. It works. There you go. 20 days it took. 20 days. So many hours. Nearly 200 hours in 20 days. There were some 14, 15 hour days. Used a recessed screw on the bottom. And obviously I merged the rotator assembly. The drawings called for a 45 degree bevel to be put on the bottom part of the rotator head. After I merged the rotator assembly, I started to hand carve the puller because I had put this together, glued it in two pieces, but I had to create this recess for the wheel. And there's really only one way to do that by hand, and that was using, clockmaking methods. And I used one of my fine pull saws to create the edges of the wheel well, and then took another pull saw and did this cross sawing method. Now, I was very careful to tape in a backstop for all this. It's very important to protect the work. And after I had gotten a chisel down and filed a little bit, got the bottom all nice and smooth, checked it with the wheel and put the wheel in and the pin to test the fit, and it was just right. And then I had to flip it over, and there were these two 45 degree bevels on the underside of the puller that it called for in the drawings. So I went and just hand did those using a 45 degree guide with the chisel. This is where it's getting to be, ancient techniques. And the final step for the puller was to drill the hole for the latch arm pin. And that I scrawled the crosshairs using the compass method, taking the measurement from the caliper with the compass to cross the little X on the top. And all of the pins in my assembly, they all are interference fit. So all the pins in the whole assembly could be removed. I could do test fitting and then push them out. But the one pin that is a one-way only is the one that is in the puller because there's no bottom to that. And so that pin I shaped in a certain way with a certain taper that when I was ready for the final assembly, I would push that pin in with a final snap. And it was flush and level. And when I did that final snap in for the final assembly, that pin was never coming out. and it was done and done. The last thing I had to do after I had gotten all the parts all sanded, it took a few days actually to hand sand and contour and get all the imperfections and tool marks out of all the different parts of the assembly. After I'd gotten them all polished down with fine sandpaper, I oiled everything with Danish oil. And hung all the little parts on this little makeshift tree, drying tree that I made up out of some scraps and some wire that I could hang all the parts on so they wouldn't be sitting on a surface. And with Danish oil, it's got varnish in it. It's sort of like an oil varnish mixture. So it penetrates into the wood and then solidifies in the wood. So it makes the surface of the wood harder and more chip resistant. So I let that sit overnight to fully harden. And the next day did the final assembly, snapped those last final pins in, and it was done. The only thing I had to do, the only last step that I had to do was to make the brass inserts for the bolt holes on the base. Chopped them out, filed them down, finished them, and these brass inserts were all interference fit. Again, the
holes were made, you know, just to the exact tolerance, and I just pushed them in very finely with a block, and you know, they're sitting there all nestled. The brass inserts will help in taking the load of the bolts, and also, you know, prevent any chipping. The arc of using wood and brass, walnut and brass, people have commented that it's a very Jules Verne kind of a thing, and that's really what I was shooting for, because I incorporated the most modern technology along with the most tried and true historic woodworking techniques to make this latch replica. It became a transcendent experience for me to create this, a labor of love, an object of love, my passion for space, my passion for making things, my love of wood, and just, yeah, my blood, sweat, tears, my heart is in this piece. And so it's an honor for me to be able to include this in the Adam Savage project, have it assembled at the Smithsonian and have it archived there. I lose the words to describe the feelings of, I'm humbled and honored to have been able to do this. And the end result is that it's just, I'm so proud of this. I seldom import the word pride into a sentence in relation to things I do, but I'm very proud of this latch. It was a formative experience for me. Hey, it's Fran, again, and I'm back in Washington, D.C., where I am going to be joining Adam Savage and his crew for the monumental building of the Apollo 11 Project Egress Hatch. This is an actual moon rock.
An actual sample from the moon. It was brought back from Apollo 17. So 1972. So this is the actual little piece that's right there.
I just touched a moon rock. I just touched a moon rock. For real. Wow. Harrison Schmidt, the geologist astronaut, brought that rock from the moon, Apollo 17, and I just touched it with my bare finger. Real moon rock, atoms on my fingers. I've touched the moon, for real. And my latch is in there. It's over there, right there in that building. Let's go inside. Things have really changed here since the last time I was here. I got the Mercury capsule behind glass. Freedom 7. And they brought the LEM out here, LEM 2, out in the front lobby. Interesting thing about LEM 2 is that I had learned from the curators that the upper brass was not very happy with the fact that I took apart a Disky back in 2014, but they told me, the curators told me, that it was because of that teardown that we did of that real Disky that they were able to get all the information and skills that they needed to install a Disky in this very LEM when they restored it a couple years ago. So it was a win-win. I was really glad to get a nod that my little project actually helped restore this LEM. Pretty cool. This crate is...
Oh, no way. They included all the stickers. Oh, that's beautiful. Did you see this?
Oh, my gosh.
They included all the stickers and the labeling and everything. Incredible.
Hopefully that's the last one.
Ready?
punch is spilled all the time. That was fun.
What made you pick the
main
module
afterwards?
It seemed easy.
Hey, Adam, you're cracking on the side.
It's cracking on the side.
Here, I'm going to fix that right now.
Latches have started.
Applause to Jen Schachter, who shepherded. Now I'd like all the makers who contributed to come up on stage and sign their work, please, if you would.
Mission accomplished. It's done. So that's it for me. I'll see you back in the lab after I've come back down to Earth. I'm still orbiting the moon right now. And thanks everyone for making this possible. All those great patrons and all the fans and the ones I met today. Thank you. I'm Fran. I gotta go back to Earth now. It's been quite a ride.
Take it serious here.
on this day.
This is my demo reel. Take one.
I know what you want. The amulet.
Hey, you've got my amulet. No! We are not going to run away in fear. The blood wolf must be found. It must be destroyed. Don't go quoting regulations to me, mister. I am the captain of this ship.
Copernicus, this is Houston. You are go for landing. Repeat, you are go for landing.
Okay, so there we go, my demo reel. This tape will self-destruct in 5 seconds. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
with a redo of the original vent hood that I did to go together to form the two pieces at the top. And I'm also marking which sides I'm going to polish up and which are not, because when I actually go and join these parts together, the parts of the box that get joined, those edges have to be rough. Move it around a little bit, and it takes about 24 hours to fully set. I'm going to set those aside, and I'm going to be using squaring blocks to keep everything at a 90 degree angle to the table. And I'm using these blocks with sticky tape, and the squaring blocks are helping me to align the middle and put it, you know, where it should be. And yep, it's doing pretty good. And I use blocks to hold the ends on and everything. Yep, that's the whole thing right there, all glued together, and had to sit overnight with the blocks, and it looked pretty good even before. And then the next day, take all the blocks away. Here we go, putting it all in place. And now I've gone and added some thin layers of foam to the plywood parts, again, just to help with the sealing. And the two parts of the hinges, I've put little nuts on the ends so that I can get them in and out, again, for removing the face if I need to. So I thought that was a nice upgrade too. So I don't know exactly how, you know, much I'm going to have to open this up or take it off, you know, but makes it easy for future stuff. Add a couple of bump-ins in the corners, and these act as little rests because the hinge does add some thickness to it. So when I open up the case and put it over the top, the little bump-ins, they sit like little feet, and it's a nice rest. So that really completes the whole thing. And I really hate taking this stuff off acrylic. It's just, but with a little work, patience, it is done. It's all done. Looks very space age. It's like something from the Thunderbirds. I'm very happy with how this turned out. It looks good, and it's exactly right, and it's a perfect seal. And to run a test print. Looks pretty good. To get models off of the build plate, a sharp chisel, if you just kind of leverage it, just use the sharp edge just to kind of grab the very edge of the print, and it's just enough, if you're very gentle with it, to just kind of pop the print right off the print bed. Again, without doing any kinds of adjustments or refinements. Looks pretty good. I'm pretty happy with that. So there you go, we're ready to rock. New vent hood, Mark II, looks good, works perfectly, a good seal, very space age. Looks like it should be on Tracy Island. Maybe Brains could borrow my printer now. Hey, it's Fran, again, with a very, very special thanks to each and every one of you who has subscribed to my channel over these past 8 years or so that I've been doing this, because you have grown to a group of dedicated viewers, 100,000 strong. I can't believe it. 100,000 subscribers to my YouTube channel. That's just, what? Right, just stick it down. And there you go. Your pencil's right there, and you just pull the pencil out. Ready to sketch, put the pencil back. And it's held on secure. The clip holds the facets of the hex-shaped pencil, and it can't be yanked out, pulled out, anything like that. You can, like, you know, and you can even, like, carry the book with it, you know? It's that strong. So it really is the ultimate way. And even with the simple thing, the book itself protects the tip. See, so you don't have to do the full thing, but the full size, again, same thing. You take the tape off the back, whoop, and position it on the sketchbook where you want to put it. And there you go. It's on the sketchbook. So you open up the book, whoop, It's actually a sketch of the item. Look, I guess my hope is that people who watch my channel will sort of let go a little bit, maybe watch a video that they wouldn't necessarily want to watch and connect the dots that this is about electronics and that, you know, doing cabinetry really is about electronics in the truest sense, and that the look of the final product is the most important, and the feel of controls and the look of displays and how all these layers create a three-dimensional vision of electronics, not just the thin veneer that everyone is attracted to, you know, that the core of electronics is in the layers of design that it takes to get there to a complete, finished, three-dimensional object that interacts with you, looks great, smells great, feels great, operates and has the kinds of displays and controls and layout and design and graphic arts and silk screening and woodworking and the kind of wood grain and the kind of finish and everything. It all combines to, you know, some indescribable, indefinable, total aesthetic with the electronics silently humming on the inside, making it all function. And that's sort of my reverse engineering the wonder of electronics throughout my own life to create with my lifetime of knowledge and skills a thing that the child in me would just wonder at first sight and marvel at how it looks, how it feels, smells, and cause my imagination to bristle about how they did that and what could possibly be making it work on the inside. And I think that's what I've been trying to do all of my adult life, is to make things that would capture the endless wonder of my inner child, to discover that thing that I painstakingly built for the first time. And that's what electronics is to me. But it is, after all, just a prop, and the buttons are not real. They're just pieces of plastic with lights in them, and there's an operator, you know, sitting off screen who's doing all the work and turning things on and off and whatnot. So I wanted to make sure that my panel would do everything that the panel in the film would have done. All of the switches have to articulate, they have to all click, and they all have to light up, and they all have to reset. But they have to look the same, feel the same, but be real switches that can be used to switch anything that I'd want to switch. I wanted to make these three-finger-sized, incandescently lit, clickety switches for real, and build a panel that would really function. The switch construction would consist of a hollow plunger with receptacles in the plungers for the incandescent lights, which I would also incorporate into the actual contacts for the switch. There would be a guide for the plunger as well, and that would keep the plunger straight and hold the plunger in, and there'd be a back contact plate behind the guide assembly for the other end of the switch and the other set of contacts. And there'd be a springy foam, a regular polyurethane foam, that I would put in between the plunger and the back plate to create the proper springy feel and the right kind of feel for the switch overall, and so it would give it the proper action. I designed the CAD files in such a way that when the parts were finally printed, that the printing grain of the guides would run perpendicular to the grain of the plungers, and that would make for smooth operation without any grinding or gritting in the action. And I determined that the best way to do that was to make the guides in two pieces, printed in a way that used no supports and have a smooth interior surface. And these two mirrored halves would be bonded together with cyanoacrylate glue to form the completed guide assemblies. The extended legs on the guides would allow clearance for the contact areas underneath and also provide on the top side a platform against which the skirts that were on the bottom of the plungers could rest. And I also used the orbital to sand down the sides of the tiles by stacking them together, holding them tight with a clamp, and using the tape as a hold down again, skimmed over the sides, all four sides, and success. These tiles look indistinguishable from the ones in the film. Definitely good enough for the camera. And adding this diffuser, it finally created the perfect look for my real big ass buttons. Hey, it's Fran again in the lab with, look at this. It's the console from the Space Station number 5 documentation area of 2001 A Space Odyssey. It's right here in my lab. And it works. The shot from the movie, English, it works. Oh, this was so much friggin' work. I started this project in July, and I had the switches constructed and everything. I did the video about making the switches and everything, but actually building the whole panel, this took so many hours. It uses relay logic, so I have a real output, switched output for every switch. The keypad is all a momentary contact, but all of the buttons do illuminate as an extra bonus, and they go to their own board. And the language switches are all latching, so I can make selections, you know, as many selections as I want, and reset. And I have the panel set up so that the zero button is the universal reset for all the for the bus. So hit that and it resets the panel. Because I built a real relay matrix for this, which I'll show later on if you want to stick around and see how I made this. The bulbs have been tested. The switches are all assembled, and so four spots of cyanoacrylate glue on the backing plate are going to hold the guide assembly in position. At this point, I'm testing again, making sure that all the solder connections are good, making sure that I have even illumination on all the lamps in case there's a dodgy connection or something. So I'm going to extend the same process to cut the larger openings for the translation language button holes. All of the back switches, all the back contacts, are all going to be put into one common bus. Panel's all wired up. Looks pretty, I must say. So this is my original sketch for the relay logic, which I prototyped in the first video using these 12-volt double-pole, double-throw little single-coil relays. They have a really nice small footprint. And so I'm making up a matrix of 11 relays, the idea being that each flip-flop uses a single bus for its latching, and that bus is connected to the reset relay, and pushing the zero throws that one relay, which cuts out the reset bus and resets all the flip-flops that are engaged on the panel to interface with the switches, and that's pretty much it. Looks pretty, must say. Looks very pretty. Okay, so here it is. The first test. I got it all wired up. Dual supply. First time trying it out. Power up. All right, we have latching. And reset. It works. It works. Was there ever any doubt? Okay, time to try combinations. Let's try two selections. All right, and reset, it works. All right, all of the push buttons on the numerical keypad. They all light up. Got power to all the contacts. Testing all the bulbs. I went through and tested different combinations of switches. Every combination works. All the bulbs work. All the contacts make contact. Perfect. 100% functional. Using the same techniques with a little help from a little screwdriver to get the labels on the small numerical tiles. Again, using a transparency to protect it while burnishing. All right, so I've got the vellum stuck down on all the tiles, and now all I have to do is trim them down. Procedure, eliminating the button, putting the cyanoacrylate glue down, putting the next tile on, and just making sure I have a little bit of clearance between the two tiles, and pushing on a little bit to make sure they don't rub together. And then doing the third. A little bit of tremor, my tremor showing up. When I tried to do this really high detail work, it really shows up. Let that dry. And the final tile. One last check, and they're all done. Just gotta dry. Take off the guide and top panel on, and it is done! It's done! Ah. Look at that. Come on here. Look at that. All right. Oop. The perpetual thing there. Yeah. All right. I'd like to thank the Academy of YouTube. Igor! Was hast du mit meinem Computer gemacht? Es ist tot! Und du auch! Ah! Guten Abend! And the silken, sad, uncertain rustling of each purple curtain thrilled me, filled me with fantastic terrors never felt before. So that now, to still be the beating of my heart, I stood repeating to some visitor entering entrance into my chamber door. Some late visitor entering entrance into my chamber door. Yes, of course, that is it, and nothing more. Presently, my soul grew stronger. Hesitating then, no longer, "Sir," said I, "or madam, truly your forgiveness I implore, but the fact is I was napping, and so gently you came rapping, and so faintly you came tapping, tapping at my chamber door, that scarce was sure I heard you. Here I opened wide the door. Darkness there, nothing more. Hey, everybody. It's Fran in the lab again. Taking into consideration that signal is going to be going to that TM2291 chip, I should be able to just trigger it by taking this output from the sensor, or take that wire and just, you know, tap it to the V plus center correctly, so I can just drop it right in the spot. Contact. Applying a little pressure just to get the contact just right. So sticky. Ugh. All right. Jeez. It's always something. All right. Set it off accidentally, but it's working. Okay. There you go. That was a constructive two and a half hours or something like that I spent. It'll be condensed down for the version you're going to see, but my whistle and red alert. All right, it works there. Fran, in the lab, but I got the guitar on because I wanted to make a special video about the Franocaster, and I built this guitar around, I guess, 2004, I guess the summer of 2004, and it really was the result of a need for the brightest possible guitar that I could get. And so rather than just buying off the rack, I sought to just really make the exact guitar that I wanted. And so the body is, I made it out of a solid piece of swamp ash. It's actually a block that's bisected and opened up and then joined into like a flat piece. So there is a seam. Let's see, maybe it's kind of, it's pretty hidden, but basically it's all from like one original block of a really hard dry swamp ash, and it took a few weeks to actually make the body. It's nitro lacquered, the whole guitar is nitro lacquer, and I lacquered it with very, very thin coats. I thinned the lacquer so that I would do like two wet coats, let it dry for a day, and then I'd sand the whole body down and then do another two wet coats. And I did this process over like a week or so, just getting the finish on until I had the lacquer build up just thick enough, but not too thick, because the reason I went with an all nitro lacquer guitar and the reason I made the finish as thin as I could is all for the acoustics. I needed it to ring. I needed the body to be very bright. I didn't want it to be dulled. And it's all about those very fine details. It took a while to shape, but I actually contoured the guitar because it's got the Tele profile front, and it's also got these the body reliefs from the Strat. So it's relieved here and in here and in the back too. So when you're sitting with the guitar and when it's up against the body, it's got all those smooth sort of worn bar of soap contours to it. So it feels like a Strat when you wear it and play it, but it's got the tone and the weight and the density of a Tele. I used a real Telecaster hardware, 70s era Tele pickups. Electronics, no tone control, just two volumes and the gear shifter in the back. And people have made a note that I flipped the controls around, which I did because I wanted the volume in the front and the gear shifter in the back. You can see some of the reliefs I had to do on the bridge there. I had to cut out the bridge a little bit to get the strings to pass through. For the benders, I see how they extend out the back. And then getting the alignment just right and the tuning, it took some time. There's lots of licks you can do. I'm not really a natural player, but the sort of ubiquitous lick would be to bend up a major second up to a third full step, and it sounds something like this. And that's a very common lick that's in a lot of Nashville stuff. And but why would you want to do that? Well, it goes back to the old rivalries in Nashville between the pedal steel players and the Nashville guitar players. And the guitar players, those guys were real. It was the Wild West as far as music goes. And those Nashville guitar players, they were the earliest and first to adopt every single kind of electronic trick, gizmo, gadget, new technique. It was all about having a one-up on someone else and being able to do a little bit more. One of the things it also does, when you drop the tuning of the E string down to a D, it also changes chording. Because in the regular major chording, looks like that, right? When you drop the E to a D, it changes the chording to this. And it also changes the dynamic of chords, like another major chord variation would be like this for D major. But when you drop the A to a G, basic idea of having a trick guitar, being able to do bends, dropping the tuning. It really makes it a versatile guitar to do all kinds of licks. Falling within the same week, we got Hanukkah and Kwanzaa and Christmas and the solstice all coming to
Boxing Day.
And Boxing Day all happen in the same week. And so I've done something a little special and I'm mailing it to Santa. Yep. This is a guitar amp and fuzz tone in a holiday card. I kid you not. Merry Fuzzmas! Merry Fuzzmas to you! Yeah, rock on! Yep. And like I said, this is a completely operational an interface, because we have to deal with the real world. So I've got to be able to plug a quarter inch, you know, guitar patch cable, and I have to be able to power it. Got a little bit of wine from the cell tower.
Thank you.
minimum capacitors, no dropping resistors, straight output, as simple as it gets. And it worked. It definitely worked. But it was a little faint for what I wanted, and I thought, well, what I really like is for this to really rock. So I want to have like an overdrive in it. So I just took that out and I put in another stage, another LM386, just put it in one isolation cap. And because of the additional gain, I had to add another cap to roll off some of the input to take off the radio and as much as I could, because the cell phone tower outside is just, if everything isn't grounded. So I had to find a way to like kind of roll off some of that interference. But it was just a simple two-stage circuit. Tested it. Just put down a piece of double-sided foam tape to just tape the whole thing down onto the card. And made an inner sleeve just out of another piece of cardstock. Used some glue stick. Glued that down to make an inner cover. It's it. Works. It's a real deal, and it's completely envelope sized, ready to go to the North Pole. Yep. Okay, so at this point, there's another thing. There are no photographs of the completed assemblies, which is something that would be typical. Let me see how this is going to go together. So this board, this backboard, is going to have the power supply. It's going to be facing inward, and the buttons are going to be on the back, even though the description for the buttons is on the top side. They're actually going to go on the back, so this is going to go that way. Okay, so that makes sense. So it can stick out. They don't give you drawings.
in the description of like showing that in place. A lot of times what they do is Heathkit would not only just show you how to put this, but they would show you either drawing or photograph of the board where that's going in, or in the description of, you know, how it angle. Yeah, just going by text, so, jeez. I'm bending it all apart. Oh, crud. Oh, that will not come apart. All right. Take no prisoners. I'm using a block so that, because you got these things. So hopefully, yeah. Okay, so that there and her. Right. Get out the heavy artillery. All right. There we go. I'm breaking it along the line here. Come on. Ah, there we go. That was enough. shouldn't be that hard. I should have banged it on both sides. Sound of shredding fiberglass, which is not good because now there's all this because it's not scored through. Now there's all this shredded fiberglass all along the edge of the board. That was necessary because there was just all these sharp, jagged chunks of fiberglass hanging off the edge of the board, because that was, you know, not anywhere near through.
End of part three.
And the dramatic conclusion of the completion of the assembly of the circuit board for the Heathkit GC1006 clock kit. So, yeah. I guess we're gonna be coming back for part four. What if little snags and snafus and stuff, some unanticipated issues. Also, there was an error in part two. That too is very inventive, I think. It allows you to have the clear window here and the tint there. I do wonder long-term, like if this was in area where it'd be exposed to light, if that would, you know, fade. Alrighty. Almost done this part of the assembly. Almost done putting in this last screw. All right, assembly, and the little switches have come through, so all right, there you go. Success. Another Heathkit clock. Whew. Done and done. Success! It works! So, another Heathkit clock. So, alright, final impressions. The build had some issues, definitely. Not everything was necessarily explained, although a few things that were explained I neglected to do, which I had to go back and correct because I just got bored of following the instructions. That's probably another Heathkit tradition, because how many people who put together a Heathkit in the old days did just get to a point after maybe the second day and just say, I'm tired of reading this, I'm just going to do it. but a few reservations. I mean, if there are a few things in there I definitely would want differently. It could be made better. But I do want, and I make this my final thought, I really do want the new Heathkit company to succeed. I really do. And I hope that they'll, you know, like I said, go to the fan base. It's already there. You know, talk to the fans. Start up a forum. Let them tell you what they want. They'll tell you. And it'll help you to meet that mark of expectation. That a very high bar was set in the old days. I think that if you're going to put out something with Heathkit name, you've got a high bar to meet, but you have to try to do your best to get as close to that bar as you can if you're coming out with a Heathkit product. I know that, you know, if anything I put out that has Frantone on it, it's got a very high bar to meet, and I wouldn't put out a product that wasn't 100% exactly the way I wanted it to be if it's got Frantone on it. So Heathkit should be no less. Hey, it's Frantone time again. So I got a pedal in for repair. It's not very often that I get a pedal in for repair. if you know anything about Frantone, my pedal company, always used top-notch parts, but they're not invincible. Even though I build them like a tank, people do find ways to blow them up or whatever. And I got one in for repair. I think someone had gotten it off of eBay or something and gotten it, you know, as is. Looks like it's had some hard time. So I just wanted to replace some parts and go over a little bit of troubleshooting for basic issues. Stuff like that. Just a quick little video. So what do we got today? This is classic fuzz. This is one of the original runs. It's from 2003. The first run of the classic fuzz that I did, it was in a green. I called it Cosmonaut Green with the red knobs, but later changed to beige because I went to epoxy paint. And this was the epoxy version from 2003. And some parts have been changed out. It looks like it had had some issues. Often what happens with a lot of pedals that I get back is people blow them up either by plugging like a 24 or 30 volt power supply into them, or they put in an adapter with a reverse polarity. I have my own sort of very specific sort of Frantone trademark crowbar in there to protect my pedals. Basically, I started putting them in a form of crowbar, which is a... Fran, what the hell is a crowbar? You've actually put like a crowbar in there? Now, it's a very simple circuit that acts very quickly to counter catastrophic things such as reversing the polarity of the input voltage or over-voltaging the pedal. And there's lots of ways it can be done. Most pedals would have just a simple diode in line with the power input to prevent catastrophic failure if you flip the polarity. But even though that's a very simple and cheap way to do it, it does come at a sacrifice of the top voltage of, better part of a volt. And one of the things that I really sought out in the early days of Frantone was to make sure that I could maintain the very highest operational voltage in the circuit, because a lot of my overdrives and fuzz tones and stuff, they really performed optimally when the supply voltage could be as close to 9 volts as possible. And so I wanted to make sure that my protection circuits wouldn't really impede that too much. Let's take a look inside. So yeah, I took a quick look in here, and this has been serviced because the solder on the DC jack is not original. It's been resoldered, and this Zener is sort of the remnant of the one of my old crowbars, but it's probably shorted. And the 9-volt plug has been changed, because I always use these hard plastic cap type. Yeah, that diode was cracked in half, so that was definitely no good. The socket is slightly melted, so the nuts won't come off when the socket is melted and distorted, so I've got a way around that. There we go. There we go. Ugh. Yeah, it's the only way to get a burned, melted jack out. All right. Gotta have the right nut driver. for the job. Makes it so much easier. It's harder to get that nut fastened after this block has been put in. I usually do that first, but it requires a special wrench. I put a little bevel there on the wrench. It allows me to get really close to the case and, you know, get behind the nut. But yeah, this is one of my oldest custom tools for Frantown stuff. Indispensable. It's not a capacitor. It's a 10-ohm PTC, positive thermal coefficient thermistor. It's a lot easier to do this when it's being manufactured because, again, that's like a pre-done assembly that's just dropped in. But doing this kind of surgical stuff to fit something in place after the fact, it's always a little more difficult. They were going to say, Fran, why don't you use sockets? You wouldn't have to do that. Well, I don't use sockets because it's bad to use sockets with audio stuff, anything analog. Had a lot steadier hand 20 years ago, that's for sure. Okay. All right, got the new op amp in there. The classic fuzz, it's actually a transistorized effect. I'm using two MPS-18s to actually create the effect, but uses an LM386 just as a current and signal boost into the tone circuit so that you can just get the right kind of amplitude on the output rather than having two more transistor stages. It just it made the board layout simpler and it didn't affect the tone at all. But it just enhanced the performance. So yeah, it's a hybrid design, hybrid transistorized op amp. So yeah, let's give it a try. This is ready to go back to its owner, running as good as new. This is really why I started putting the crowbar in, because of these sorts of blow-ups, and kind of changed it over the years. Originally, I just used like a 2-watt power resistor to sync that, but then I like the idea of it being resettable, and so ever since these last runs, I've been using the PTC, and I'm really a big fan of the thermistors for doing this sort of job. But from now on, it'll be protected, so if somebody flips the polarity or overvoltages it, it won't blow up again. So, yeah. Making it more bulletproof. Okay. Hey, it's Fran. Trailer reaction time. Not just a trailer for, like, any movie, but a movie that features, at least in small part, a little bit of yours truly. It's the Pedal movie.
I got into doing that with the two rappers both together, and just flat as a pancake, and the note would go on forever.
There's a lot of women building pedals right now, a lot.
I learned everything that you never are supposed to do in a pedal business in those first 8 months.
It's important that we're doing something that nobody else.
Hey, it's Fran again. I'm not in the lab, though. I'm in the Northeast Philadelphia Airport because today I'm going to learn how to fly that plane. In the lab. Doing stuff.
making something. In the lab. It's what I'm doing. Working out. On the bench. In the lab. Yeah.
All right, right now you're steering with your brakes, correct?
I am steering with my feet. That's correct.
All right.
Take off runway 24 Juliet on course, and we'll be looking to change over to Philadelphia approach. All right, so I'm looking. Nobody's there. Want to make sure nobody's landing, right?
Yeah.
We're going to steer out to the center line. Nice and clear in front of us. Good. Now my heels go on the floor. I don't want to hit the brakes now. I'm going to increase the throttle all the way in. Now I've got that right rudder going in to keep us turning from the left, right? All that left turning tendency. Keep it on the center line. I'm looking for 60. And when we hit 60 knots, I'm just going to lift the nose. And the airplane flies itself right off the ground. I'm going to try and keep it over the center line.
Really climbing.
We're climbing at about 1,000 feet per minute. Excellent, excellent climbing capabilities.
This has really got some chutzpah.
Oh yeah. She's a beaut. Flies great. And that's pretty much our heading, is straight ahead.
Yep.
But we're not sure where they're gonna send us.
Feeling a little bit of instability in the air there.
Well, it's just some little bit of turbulence. It's very normal.
Because we got heat rising.
And that's what we're feeling.
Yeah. Now I got my ears popping, so we're
moving.
We got the altimeter. We just crossed 1,000 feet.
1,000 feet above sea level.
Sea level, right. And where did we start out?
About 120 feet.
Okay. Wow. Visibility is like hundreds of miles.
He's going to need to give me a handoff real soon.
Blanche, 589, P-Mount 4046, turn right direct Stone. Right direct Stone, P-Mount 4846. RC Cap 4628, 1545, heading Q45.
For Cap 4628, South Elevator 5, rate of contact, climb and maintain 10,000.
Climb and maintain 10,000, care 4628.
That's really something.
November 9, Charlie Victor, thanks. Descend via the Maisy 2. Booster 5290, contact New York Center 135.45.
3545,
200. Exit at 769, contact New York Approach 132.8.
So right base for 27. Okay.
Yeah. Sir, 86 Lima, are you a Skyline or a Skyhawk?
That's a Cessna Skyhawk, 86 Lima.
Roger, thank you.
You said right base, that means we're going to come by on the right side and come around.
I'm going to be at basically 90 degrees to the runway. So 27 minus 90.
Okay, got it.
About 180 on the heading.
And for the people watching, we're gonna do what they call a touch and go.
Touch and go.
It means you land and then you don't stop.
Yeah.
Gonna get the wheels down and then we're gonna take off right again.
I know, you know, now I'm just balancing pitch and power to get me where I want to be. That's about right. I want to be about 500 feet over the field as I turn final. There's my aiming point. There we go. We'll start our turn.
There's the runway.
There's the runway.
That was perfect.
Wind check.
Wind 240 at 8, gust 15.
All right. So we're looking really good.
We're almost right into the wind.
Yep, that helps.
Yeah.
A little bit of a crosswind. We'll compensate for that.
Yeah, it's coming a little from the right, right?
Yep.
Okay.
240. It's got a little bit off. Bring in a little extra speed with the wind.
Tower, Trooper 5.
Trooper 5, Wilmington Tower.
Sir, we're going to do a 180 and just reestablish our inbound heading. And we'll call Hayden inbound.
Trooper 5, roger.
So, you can just let it settle in. Don't rush it. Don't push it down. Sort of let it settle.
And that's the stall. Whistle there.
There you go. All right, now I'm going to take my flaps up.
Right.
Take my time.
We're on the ground. Very temporarily. All right.
There's my 60, and I'm ready to go.
Up.
And we'll get ready here.
We are climbing. And you just loaded in Northeast Philadelphia.
I did indeed.
Right. That was a touch and go.
That was it.
So I heard the stall whistle just before we hit the
As it should. Back. That's exactly what we want to hear.
And so just it was just a very gentle touch.
Tower on 118.5 of it.
Coming up in airspace in a few minutes.
Come on.
And eventually he's gonna switch us over to tower. Oh, again.
Yeah.
Oh dear.
I think it's thermal.
I just got warm, you think?
Yeah, it's overheating.
700 Julius Sierra Southwest approach, northeast altimeter 3033, lower shortly.
So I'm hoping the one outside will be cool enough.
Reach 219.
We'll start my right turn, start slowing it down. And slowly we're going to get into that white arc.
2549, Quebec, we're on left downwind runway 34.
Once I get to the white arc, I can start putting in flaps.
More flaps. Proceed direct to the number. Tighten it up here.
3060,
Yankee. 2549, Quebec, spin down, I'll call base.
Staying on downwind, 49, Quebec.
Citation 700, Julius Sierra, turn left, taxiway Alpha, ground point 7.
Julia, turn left, Alpha, ground point 7.
86 Lima, turn.
86 Lima, roger, clear to land. Caution, wait, turn.
86 Lima, roger.
All right.
And there's our runway.
Yep.
We're going to manage our airspeed, our descent. And the lights are giving us two red and two right. We're right on the glide slope. Since he wants me to land kind of short, I'm going to drop all my flaps. Keep us away from that wake turbulence.
We need to follow the traffic ahead, extend down when you'll call base.
Add a little power as we start to sink.
S-turns are approved for space, it looks like you might be catching them.
Alright, I'll make some S-turns, I see that quick enough.
Our rudder keeps us on the center line, whoa! A little bit of wind.
November 254 on Quebec, traffic ahead to your left in a mile is the Cherokee making a straight in from runway 24, altitude indicates 1,100. Do you have it in sight?
I have it in sight, 49 Quebec.
4 on Quebec, roger, number 2, follow that traffic, runway 24, cleared for the option, wind 22011.
Following that traffic, runway 24, clear for the option, 49 Quebec.
November 3063 Yankee, runway 24, clear for the option, wind 22011. Upon completion, make left, close traffic.
Well, that worked out.
I saw you did a few flares there.
3444 Quebec.
Kind of slow down a little bit.
Yeah. Start pulling me up.
Cessna 5286 Lima, turn right, taxiway. Correction, left. Sorry about that. Left, taxiway, Juliet, ground 47.
Left on Juliet, over to ground, 86 Lima.
All right. Cessna 44 Quebec, you set the immediate takeoff clearance.
Foxy Yankee, hold short of course.
Yeah, I noticed that trick. We're still going a little fast, you just pull it up a little bit,
yep.
And just, you know, air brake and stall and...
Eventually.
Northeast Philadelphia, ground 5286 Lima is off 24 Julia. We'll be taxiing over to the
City ramp.
26 Lima Northeast ground taxi via Golf Alpha, Alpha 2, cross runway 33 at Golf.
Plan this in advance so you kind of know where to put it.
0443 Sierra Lima, Northeast clearance, cleared to Bravo November Alpha Airport. Fly runway heading. Expect radar vector.
Okay, we'll do a quick shutdown.
Dennis, file.
Yeah, I have on show.
Maintain 2000, expect flight level 400, 10 minutes after departure.
Do a ground check.
123.8. Squawk 1565.
Shutdown.
That's it. Ha. She wrote.
Thanks, Howard. Thanks. It was
a pleasure.
That was amazing. It was.
Glad you enjoyed it. As you probably saw, there's a lot going on.
A lot, yeah. It was a constant with two different air traffic control centers in Wilmington and Philadelphia. And we were in Wilmington, Delaware for like 2 seconds, like
and
on
then
the ground.
Back here. Maybe. Let's do it again.
Yeah, I'd love to do it again sometime. So, thanks a lot.
You're welcome.
And, you know, they thank you too. Bye!
At the bench again.